So shall we start, Vankan sir? Shall we start?
Sure. Sure.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Respected Dr. Anil sir, Professor cum Principal MTIM, Karuset University, Mr. Vipin sir, Head of the Department Child Health Nursing, our invited speaker Dr. Ganpat Vankar sir, Professor and Head at the Department of Pediatrics, Parul University of Medical Sciences and Research, Vadodara, dear faculty and students from various nursing institutes, dear colleagues and students from MTIM. Myself, Binal Joshi, moderator of this session, welcomes you all to this webinar on grief and bereavement in the children and adolescents, behalf of Manikaka Topawala Institute of Nursing, Charleston. I request dear participants to mute yourself so we can hear better. Thank you. Hey. Now we will proceed to the session. Our today's webinar is entitled on grief and bereavement in the children and adolescents. Grief is inevitable, near-ending process that results from a permanent or temporary disruption in duty, a separation or change in the relationship that may be beyond the person's control. This disruption, change or separation cause pain and discomfort and impacts person's true feeling and behavior. Although loss is a universal experience, the causes and manifestations of it are unique to each individual and we may change over time. So sometimes it is exciting for the children and sometimes it is very painful and anxious for the children. So we very often expect certain events in their life. For instance, parents might assume that moving to a greater house or larger house in the area which is more urban, the shifting of that may create great opportunities for the children. But sometimes it will be very difficult for the child. Child may fear anxious and the may be fearful. So it's better to understand how this impacts in the life of child and adolescent. Here, I'm feeling great to introduce our today's resource person because he is an expert and he is the eminent speaker for us as he is having the expertise knowledge about all this in detail. So to have more detailed understanding, I would like to introduce Dr. Ganpat Vankar sir, who is a resource person for us today. I'm also feeling very great and delighted to introduce him as he was my teacher and I request participants to please mute yourself. So I'm feeling great to introduce sir as I am the student of him and maybe many delegates are the students of him. So here I'll have a great opportunity to introduce him. Sir is a professor and head of the Department of Psychiatry, Parul Institute of Medical Sciences and Research, Vadodara. Sir is having the teaching experience of more than 35 years of age and in various institutes of medical postgraduate and graduate in Gujarat. He is a past professor and head psychiatry department, BJ Medical College, Ahmedabad. He also served medical colleges in Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra during last 5 years. Sir was honorary editor, Archives of Indian Psychiatry. Sir belongs to research interests include psychiatry, addiction medicine, sexuality, as well as medical education. Sir is considered a leading psychiatry academician in the Western Indian states of Gujarat, Maharashtra, and Goa. Sir has guided more than 50 postgraduates, and he is an examiner at several universities and also examiner for DNB examination. He is a recipient of National Bombay Psychiatric Society Base Paper Award, Dr. A.V. Shah Base Paper Award, and Dr. R.C. Manar Best Paper Award several times. Sir is having more than 100 scientific publications to his credit. Sir has initiated Dr. G.K. Vankar Base Paper Award for postgraduates in Gujarat State. Sir has a wide experience of community awareness programs and have trained many volunteers, teachers, and health professionals in basic mental health. The profile goes and goes, but it is not ending because sir has a wide contribution in the area of healthcare field. Apart from that, he is a great poet also, and he is an intensive reader also. So here we have sir, and we have a wonderful opportunity to hear him. So now I'll give over to you, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for accepting the invitation and hosting this webinar for us. So I will give the session to, I will hand over the session to you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Very pleased to hear your introduction. I warmly welcome all the dignitaries of your institute. I, at the outset, wish to thank you, your institute, and I welcome all the participants who would be here this morning. So as the introducer has already mentioned, most human beings have experience of loss. Similarly, at some point in childhood, vast majority of children will experience death of a close family member or a friend. Approximately 1 in 20 children in US experience death of parent by the age of 16. Despite high prevalence of bereavement among children, many pediatricians, many doctors, many nurses are uncomfortable talking about and supporting grieving children as regards death. When we begin, let us see some definitions. Grief is subjective feeling precipitated by death of a loved one. So it is basically a subjective feeling, and the precipitant is death of a loved one. Whereas bereavement is state of being deprived of someone by death. Mourning is a process by which grief is resolved, and societal expression, post-bereavement, and practices. So although grief, bereavement, mourning are many at times used interchangeably, there is some minute difference. You might be knowing that this person, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, has described what is normal bereavement. Once there is death of a loved one, what would happen? So there are certain stages she has described: protest, searching, despair, detachment, reorganization. Corresponding to this, there have been described certain stages of grief by Kubler-Ross as regards grief. First is denial. In this stage, there is conscious or unconscious refusal to accept the reality of the situation. For example, person may say that the loved one is still alive. Anger. The child or adolescent may experience and perhaps express this emotion of anger. It could be directed inwards, where person would feel depressed, or towards the deceased. a family member, teacher, or healthcare worker, anyone other than oneself. Then there would be a stage of bargaining. It's also called stage of negotiation. And bargaining provides temporary escape from situation and instills hope. People often pray, practice rituals, make deal or promises in attempt to reverse the circumstances of the situation. For example, they may say that for coming year, I won't take sweets. My relative, my close one is going to survive, something like that. Then once this phase is over, then the depression sets in. During this stage, there would be a sense that death has finally occurred. People experience symptoms of depression, such as sadness of mood, lack of pleasure, hopelessness, then frequent crying, etc. And lastly, in the last stage, person would accept reality of death which has occurred. This final stage, when occurs, then person would try to adjust to the loss and would again enter into mainstream, which is called life, and would engage into all other activities which previously he was undergoing. So let me give some examples. A child may try to convince himself that his parents are having a fight and not actually going to divorce each other. This is in context of divorce. So this may be a denial. And child may then experience anger towards one or both his parents for breaking up the family. This is anger. Sometimes he may consider himself responsible for the outcome called divorce, and that is why he may feel angry towards oneself. The next stage, that is bargain, he may attempt to avoid coming in terms with the situation. He may think, if I behave like a good child, my parents will not fight and they would be together. I recollect one case in which the couple was constantly fighting, and whenever there was beginning of such fight, the child in question had hyperventilation, and without any biological reasons for losing consciousness, he would become unconscious. When this happened, the couple's fight would stop and they would begin caring for the child. So this may be a manifestation of bargaining. Once the child realizes that divorce is going to happen, then he may feel sad, dysphoric, depressed, may lack humor, may not engage into play, etc. The last stage, child accepts that parents are divorcing and he tries to adjust to the new situation. Who would be the caregiver? He would be living together, whether there would be change in accommodation, change in school, etc. Or so there would be ultimately acceptance. This Kubler-Ross model was initially developed to help terminally ill patients and bereaved adults. However, it provides valuable framework to understand process of grief in children and adolescents. What is usual duration of grief? Say, it would vary from person to person. It may last for few weeks. In our communities in India, they say that for 1 month and 1 week, sava mahino. However, equilibrium would occur only after few months. New relationships person may engage into after 6 months to 1 year. However, for some individuals, the loss will be irreparable and person will have some manifestations of grief persisting throughout lifetime. If especially the person were old and is experiencing loss, then loneliness would be one most lasting manifestation. In context of childhood and adolescence, this would be uncommon. As I mentioned, some people will have experience of this intermittent grief. This would last for certain period. They would come as brief bouts. In between, person may be totally normal. Gradually, these intermittent grief periods would shorten and there would be positive change. By that we mean that person would be remembering the person who has left life. However, person will have very positive memories, good time spent with the person concerned, and likewise the good memories, bitter and sweet, both together would occur, especially on triggers, for example, birthday of the deceased relative. Then there is something called anticipatory grief, in which if a loved one is ill for a long period and it is perceived that death is certain, then in those circumstances, process of grief would start right when the person is alive. And with this, many a times it would lead to intensification of intimacy. And say many a times it so happens that once the person is dead, at that juncture, process of grief has already ended. So later on, person may not experience grief at all. So this is in anticipation. Then there are anniversary reactions. If the person is dead, but if there is a Navaratri festival, for example, or Diwali, or if there are holidays when the person had enjoyed a lot, or if there are family functions, birthdays, the anniversary, death anniversary, or when the person himself or herself becomes same age of the deceased, then anniversary reactions would occur. Grief related, all emotions would flood at these particular events. However, this experience is short-lasting, mild, and usually there is quick restoration of normal life. There's something called complicated bereavement, in which the grief process is abnormal, atypical, distorted, morbid. Other words used are traumatic grief, unresolved grief, and persistent complex bereavement disorder, which has been described as some condition which requires further deliberation, research, diagnostic, and statistical manual version 5. Grief can be chronic, hypertrophy, delayed, and maybe descriptively, it may be prodromal for major depressive disorder. You mentioned chronic grief when there is a very prolonged kind of grief, person would repeatedly remember the deceased one, person may not engage into normal life activities. Usually it is associated with bitterness, idealization. The deceased person is considered an ideal person. Especially chronic grief occurs when relationship is very close or ambivalent. Person may be perceived as good and bad at the same time, or if the person were highly dependent on the person, or when other people are not that supportive compared to the person who has departed. Chronic grief is most common type of complicated grief. Usually, considerable time after loss, an adolescent continues to experience and show sign of grief even 4 years after losing a close friend. In such cases, it is important to understand what remains unresolved in the grief process. Hypertrophic grief is considered when there is some unexpected and sudden death. Here, the grief manifestations are very intense. Usually, person becomes withdrawn. Maybe very similar kind of a situation when one becomes unconscious, for example. When the stressor is extreme, the coping mechanisms become ineffective. This may lead to disruption and stability of family. Although it may run long-term course, usually there is later reduction in manifestations of grief. Delayed grief is considered when immediately after the loss, there are no signs of grief. However, once the time goes, later on, when the person recognizes what would be the consequences of person's loss, there may occur experience of grief. Prolonged denial may be also associated with delayed grief. Anger and guilt are two keywords which may be associated with delayed grief. Especially, the child may consider that he has been betrayed, the primary caregiver has died, and the person, the child, has been left halfway in the course of life. Sometimes children may have intense guilt feelings, although they have no fault, but because there would be, especially in preschool children, especially if their cognitive development is such that they would see themselves in center of the world, then they may consider that because they have not followed what the disease has mentioned, for example, study. My father has asked me to study well. I have not studied well, and as a result, he is gone. So this kind of guilt occurs. Very many times there is no proper reason for this guilt. Guilt, if is severe without any antecedent events leading to guilt, may be a manifestation of later onset of depression. A traumatic bereavement we consider when there is sudden loss. This loss has been, say for example, as a result of sudden vehicular accident, or as a result of a event like natural calamity, earthquake, flood, fire, etc. This traumatic bereavement may be chronic plus hypertrophic. Features of both may be present. There would be recurrent, intense bouts of grief. Person consistently yearns for the person. Where is my mother? Where is my mother? I wish to join her. Something of that sort. Longing for the deceased. The person may have recurrent images of death, distressing avoidance and preoccupation with reminder. For example, there was a death at a particular point on the road. The child or adolescent would avoid going to that place because say, going there would say, remind the person of what has happened. Then, usually in traumatic bereavement, positive memories are blocked, and that is why the experience is so depressing. There would be impairment in functioning. For example, child may not play, may not go to school, may not study. Many a times, traumatic bereavement may precede a psychiatric disorder. There may be history of psychiatric disorder earlier. Especially in old age or even in adults, as a result of bereavement, there would be impaired health, both bodily as well as emotionally. For example, there may occur worsening of pre-existing medical disorders. Especially in elderly, if a spouse has died, it has been mentioned that there would be high mortality. Or especially men with heart attacks. And this may be related to several bodily changes as well as depression associated. As a consequence, as such, suicide is quite uncommon. Only in context of depression, suicide occurs. Simple bereavement usually does not lead to a suicide. Death by accident, ischemic heart disease, infectious disease, cirrhosis, all these occur more commonly, more frequently after experiencing the grief. Psychiatric complications include major depressive disorder, prolonged anxiety, panic, post-traumatic stress disorder, substance use. Especially bereaved children are vulnerable as regards substance use as well as depression. It's also important to separate depression and bereavement, grief and depression. So let us compare both. Usually, bereavement, only few people would meet criteria for major depressive disorder. Usually, there are no suicidal ideation. There is no poor self-esteem or a feeling of worthlessness. No guilt as regards, say, I have committed something wrong. Only in preschool children, guilt may be present. Psychomotor retardation usually does not occur with bereavement. Then dysphoria means sadness occurs, but this is usually in context of reminders or triggers. Usually, grief has onset within 2 months of onset. Duration of symptoms is usually less than 2 months. If there is a longer period, the grief have high degree of suspicion that person may be suffering from accompanying major depressive disorder. The impairment is usually transient. Life usually goes on. Person may do household chores, may attend school. However, there would be, say, hours during which person would remember the departed one and may feel sad. So basically, it is only limited to some part of day, not most of the day. And usually, in normal bereavement, there is no family history or personal history of depression. When we compare it to major depressive disorder, say depression usually is diagnosed when all manifestations last for more than 2 weeks time. Out of two key manifestations, persistent sadness of mood and lack of pleasure, usually pleasurable activities must be present, and other manifestations, namely sleep disturbance, poor appetite and significant weight loss, poor concentration, difficulty concentrating, difficulty taking decisions, psychomotor retardation and agitation, helplessness, hopelessness, worthlessness, excessive inappropriate guilt, suicidal ideation are more common in major depressive disorder. Sometimes depression can occur without any precipitating event, where we would consider that it is autonomous, biologically determined depressions. Then there may be past history or family history of depression present. Then especially if the bereavement occurs following a traumatic event like unnatural and violent deaths, as I gave example of natural calamities or say vehicular accident, suicide, homicide, terrorism. These are associated usually with fear, horror, vulnerability. Usually, there are biological concomitants of grief. Usually, grief disrupts our biological rhythms. There is impaired immune functioning. There are decreased lymphocyte proliferation, which leads to vulnerability. Person is at greater risk of developing some kind of infections, and there is impaired functioning of natural killer cells, which are important for, of course, immunity. Although these biological changes are there, whether they are clinically significant or not, this is not certain at this juncture. Increased mortality in those who have lost a person, especially in widows, in men compared to women. Phenomenology of grief usually depends upon personality, earlier experiences of losses, past history of psychiatric illness, how the person perceives the loss, relationship with the disease, social network, health, and other life events which accompany grief, life cycle perspective. As I mentioned, say 4% American children lose parent by 15, who do not have Indian data. Among the losses, sibling loss is next in frequency. The child and adolescent develop manifestations which are as per developmental stage and their concept of death. For example, in a very young child, death is perceived as a temporary phenomena, like say sleep, and person considers that the parent or the deceased person will come back. Now preschool child, for example, there would be magical thinking, egocentricity. This would mean that although The child recognizes that death has occurred and it is an irreversible process. He may worry about this. Very many times, as I mentioned earlier, you may consider that this particular death has occurred because he has disobeyed, has done something wrong with the parents. And that is why, although he might not have done anything associated with the death, he may harbor extreme guilt. In child and adolescent, many a times, the grief reaction does not occur immediately after the death. The person may be, to begin with, indifferent, but later on, as he perceives what would be life without the deceased person, there would be anger, especially in childhood and adolescence. Person may not put his emotions in words. Rather, it would be expressed in form of abnormal behavior, especially anger outbursts, disobedience to other parents. In younger children, the death-related thoughts may be displayed in child's play. So, something related to adulthood, spousal bereavement is considered to be most distressing, leading to abnormal grief. Similarly, some authorities would consider next to spousal, means husband or wife's death, child's death as say more leading to more intense grief reactions. HIV/AIDS related bereavement may be also associated with stigma, guilt of being gay. It may be associated with depression, with substance use, especially in pregnant women, say late perinatal loss, if the child is stillborn or there is in the neonatal period, there is sudden infant death, and there would be severe grief reactions. Now something about complicated grief. Complicated grief means maybe prolonged grief, more intense grief. So, in fact, it is associated with difficulty managing this daily task. Person is unable to do usual task and is not adapting to the loss concerned. In complicated grief, there would be something which is leading to obstructing process of integration with the loss and moving forward with life. According to Cohen, say childhood traumatic grief is a condition in which trauma symptoms overwhelm and interfere with natural grieving process. Childhood traumatic grief usually arises with the events which I mentioned earlier. It can occur in cases of gradual anticipatory losses like terminal illnesses of parent or death due to old age, for example, death of a grandparent. Experience of trauma can lead to complicated grief, development of continued post-traumatic stress. Post-traumatic grief may be associated with post-traumatic stress disorder. It may have symptom clusters like re-experiencing, avoidance, hyperarousal, emotional and behavioral dysregulation, and distressing thoughts. Re-experiencing, the child or adolescent has distressing memories, recurrent thoughts and dreams of the person who is dead, about the traumatic event, and young children may reenact parts of the events through play. They may have also something like say flashback, in which oral earlier traumatic event surrounding the deceased date, they would recur in person's dreams. Sometimes while awake, and this leads to intense emotions as if that death is occurring just now. This is called re-experience. In avoidance, the child may begin to withdraw, move away from places, memories, and situations that remind the deceased person or the event. In hyperarousal, physical symptoms like palpitation, hyperventilation, rapid breathing, difficulty sleeping, unprovoked anger outbursts, restlessness, panic attacks, all this may occur in hyperarousal. Person may become easily startled with there is sudden sound and the surroundings. And there may be emotional and behavioral dysregulation, distressing thoughts. Child and adolescent may have trouble regulating emotions and behaviors. They may frequently have anger outbursts, distressing thoughts, self-blame. There may be learning problems. The child may poorly concentrate. There may be memory impairment. They may learn slowly. And all this may impair person's, the child's day-to-day functioning, especially school-related functioning. So usually, say, how do address grief? The task of understanding involves making sense of concept of death, death of a particular person. Child or adolescent begins to grasp the person is no longer alive and will not continue being part of his or her life. This would occur usually during, say, grief associated with, say, adolescence, young adulthood, and later on. In preschool children, there would be, say, guilt, as I have already discussed. Depending upon age and developmental stage, explanation may be offered. Three factors that could interfere with completion of task. First one is way the date is defined. Second is constant development of child understanding of the concept. And third is magical thinking. Magical thinking means I have done something which may be not associated with the date, but the child considers that this has caused date. Clinicians could address each factor to aid the healing process. In commemorating, one begins to find a way to remember the disease and memorizable the loss. For example, the child may ask to keep an object, the disease, to remember them by. Adolescents could be encouraged to participate in formal or informal rituals. These activities convey the value of life, reality of death, and help with the integration process. How to alleviate grief? What are the expressions of grief? This shall vary from individual to individual. However, it is important for clinicians to understand that there is a range of grief responses, and usually most children and adolescents come to terms with the loss, and ultimately, maybe they may take more time. However, ultimately, they resolve the grief. common responses to grief are, say, well known. I am not going into that. Some of them I have already discussed. Then let me tell you something about diagnosing complicated grief in children and adolescents. Several researchers have mentioned that there is a need for more research on grief responses in this population. Is grief a disease, a psychiatric disease? The opinion, professional opinion, is divided. Some would maintain that yes, if the grief is complicated, then it is a disorder. Some authorities would say that no, we need not medicalize what would occur normally. So there is a division in professional opinion. According to American Psychiatric Association Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, 5th version, has proposed criteria for bereavement diagnosis known as Persistent Complex Bereavement Disorder, in short, PCBD. The proposed criteria stated that children after the age of 1 year could be diagnosed with this disorder if concerns continue to persist 6 months after the death of a loved one. So there is a duration criteria. DSM mentions that certain symptoms present themselves differently in children compared to adults. For example, yearning for the deceased may manifest in behavior or themes play rather than, say, verbal output. Task force of DSM-5, they decided that because there is poor evidence to warrant inclusion of the disorder, official diagnosis, hence they have placed it under conditions for further study. Now we have short time left, so let me tell you something about treatment. Early interventions are advisable in situations when loss is traumatic or sudden in nature, when loss is significant to child or adolescent, for example, death of a very close relationship like sibling or parent. In nature of relationship with the deceased was conflicted or there was ambivalent feeling, good and bad aspects occurring together in a given individual. In those circumstances also, there's greater likelihood that the grief process would be abnormal. Signs and symptoms that appear severe and when even before the loss had occurred, if there were psychiatric issues, then such individuals may require at least monitoring and early intervention. There are two words which are important. One is called grief counseling and grief therapy. Warden has a differentiated between these two. Grief counseling is involving helping individuals work through uncomplicated grief reactions, whereas grief therapy is conducted when the individual is not able to come to terms with loss. They are having complicated grief reaction. So grief counseling is for normal grief and grief therapy is for complicated grief reaction. Each experience of grief is unique, personal and complex. However, as a result, therapists should adapt their interventions related to specific needs of the clients. Goal of grief therapy is to help children and adolescents understand and cope with their grief, helping them to adjust to new reality and integrate the loss in their lives. Therapy, one must identify and resolve the conflicts that interfere with process of bonding. Usually, psychiatric consultation is uncommon when a nursing professional is usually working in the inpatient wards, and if a child has recently experienced such loss, then they are at an advantageous position to help the children. The child or adolescent is suicidal may require urgent psychiatric care. Usually, sleep medication may be provided by any doctor, family doctor. I'm sorry. So usually, in general, how we can help? So there are certain strategies which anyone can do. One is writing. For example, the child is asked to write a letter or to keep a diary. This may be used to express thoughts and emotions regarding the loss. Writing can help to address things that were left unsaid. For example, child might have thought that for certain misdeed, he would seek forgiveness of the parent. Then child may write these things and with this expression, say grief process may be smoothened. Role playing is one activity which may be also helping. It's an effective tool to adjust to internal and external stimuli after a loss. Therapist can support child to express, play out certain situations and build skills such as boundary setting through this method. Drawing too provides a non-verbal means to express oneself in therapy. Drawings are less susceptible to defensive than talking. Hence, therapists can gain insight into child or adolescent's unconscious or repressed thoughts and feelings through this method. Cognitive restructuring is a technique used in cognitive behavior therapy. Here, the therapist believes that because person is having dysfunctional thoughts, irrational thoughts, which are also associated with some automatic thoughts, and this lead to, say, pain, psychological pain, and experience of grief-related thinking. So the child or adolescent keeps the diary hour to hour. What was his thought like and what was the emotion or mood at that particular juncture, hour to hour. And he or she brings this diary to the therapy session where the therapist would explore these thoughts further, would challenge them, and try to re-establish these irrational thoughts to rational thoughts and thereby minimizing the distress. Then child may be asked to contribute to memory books. A memory book can pose a visual and concrete aid containing photographs, poems, stories of loved ones, and other such memory things. Especially memory books are useful in school settings if there are some catastrophic events which have occurred. For example, there was earthquake and so many children had died. So surviving children can benefit with memory books. This activity helps child adolescents to remember and mourn the loss. Memory book can be added to and used to reintegrate the loss as they grow and develop. Directed imagery visualization often helps the individual who have experienced a loss. Techniques such as empty chair or conversations with the deceased can be used to resolve unfinished business. So on one chair, the child sits. On another chair, he imagines that the person who has died is sitting, and he would tell the imagined chair, the deceased person, how he is feeling about a particular thing which bothers him. And thereafter, the person changes the chair. He goes to the deceased person's chair and may respond. So child has a role play of both the individuals, the child as well as the deceased one. So this would help whatever was the unfinished business. For example, if the person comes back, what would you like to talk about? What would be the most distressing thing since the loss would like to talk, and some similar things. So this directed imagery helps. Then in Western countries, there are group support groups. However, in India, we do not have grief support groups. Usually, say, we are having excellent community support, and that is why there is lesser need for grief support groups in our settings. Usually, grief support groups can help in the Indian context if there were, say, things like, say, suicidal death of a family member, so where there would be associated stigma. I'm not going into detail. Something about play therapy. Play therapy is well established treatment approach, especially for children and adolescents, more so with the preschool children, where there would be limited, say, verbal ability. Usually in play therapy, the child is encouraged to communicate verbally or non-verbally. This is during a play session. The play session may be, say, non-directive, where therapist only observes and does not provide any guidance what kind of play he should do, compared to a directive play in which therapist usually directs what to play and likewise. In bibliotherapy, the therapeutic approach uses literature to improve mental health. You might be knowing that there is a lot of books which are available, which deal with, in story form, which deal with losses and deaths. Abnormal Personality Through Literature is one such book which provides a pieces of literature which can help, where the person would able to identify with the literary and Judith Cohen has devised trauma-focused cognitive behavior therapy, which is a short-term treatment for trauma associated with grief. It has been having best evidence for therapy success. Usually, it is used for a traumatic grief. The components are PRACTICE. P stands for psychoeducation, P stands for parenting component, R stands for relaxation skills, relaxation training, yoga, pranayama, dhyana, etc. Affective modulation skills, cognitive coping skills, trauma narrative, cognitive process, reprocessing, in vivo mastery of trauma reminders, conjoint child-parent session, and enhancing safety. I'm not going into greater detail, but let me mention something about psychoeducation, which is a simple thing. First and foremost, we must tell parents that grief is a normative experience. All people would go through. Very many times, parents should encourage children to express their feelings related to death. Usually, young children would not express verbally, but their behavior, their play would portray the themes of, say, death, loss, etc. And this is, parents should not worry, because these are the things which lead to ultimately mastery. Sometimes parents would try to hide the death. They should not do that. Rather, they should at the earliest mention that death has occurred. Regarding funeral, especially if the child is, say, beyond preschool, he may be allowed to participate in funeral, going to crematorium, etc. This would not harm the child, but it would usually, say, facilitate grief. If the family has a ritual, if child participated, then his, say, resolution of grief may be again facilitated. Regular prayer by the family members may also help. So in conclusion, say, although grief is a normative experience, not only experienced by adults who consider themselves to be more understanding, it can affect children and adolescents. Grief may occur not only due to, say, death, but maybe due to death of a pet, for example, change like relocation, or say loss of a toy, that can also lead to grief. Parents should watch their children as regards these expressions. Say health professionals, including nursing staff, have opportunity to help children and adolescents making sense of hope and heal after such an experience. It's important that to note that each individual's process is unique. We need to separate, say, bereavement from depression. If depression is present, it would require treatment on its own, and definitely there is a complicated grief. Definite intervention would help so that child adolescents would cope up with the grief and would enter mainstream of their lives. Thank you. Thank you for your patient hearing. I again thank Charu Seth University's Topawala Institute of Nursing, associated with Manikata. I also thank you all, especially Vinal Madam, who has been instrumental being with you this morning through this webinar. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Please call me Vinal only, sir. I'm your student. So thank you, sir, for delivering this very informative talk. And we really have an in-depth understanding and knowledge regarding the session. We really have many new concepts that we have learned through your session. So thank you, sir, for delivering such a wonderful talk. At the end, usually we are having the question answer session, but right now we don't have any questions. But I would like to take the participants' opinion and view. So I request if any want to give, or if any of you want to express your opinion.
Yes. So my name is Charmi, and first of all, I would like to thank sir that they have given us time and they have conducted a very nice session, and it was very informative and in-depth content, and it was my pleasure to attend this session. Thank you so much, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, you are audible, ma'am.
Good afternoon, sir. It was indeed a great pleasure to invite you for such a wonderful webinar. Sir has presented very well in a very interesting manner. I really appreciate the content which he has narrated. Especially, I love that. So it would be a great opportunity to have collab at that time so that I could have gained some knowledge. But yes, could definitely collaborate and quite more in presence to our institute when this corona pandemic will get over.
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your experiences and views. So lastly, I say thank you, everyone, for taking your time and visiting our webinar presently. And you always are there with us, dear delegates. So in future also, we expect that you always be with us. Thank you very much for attending this session. We have shared a feedback link in the chat box. Please mention your correct email ID and name when you submit your feedback form. We will be mailing you the e-certificate. We will be mailing you the e-certificate on your registered mail ID, which you will enter into your feedback form. So please, I have posted the feedback form in the chat box. Kindly fill it. And I'm also projecting the feedback link on the screen. So you can also scan the code and you can also fill the feedback form. We will be posting you the certificates very shortly to your registered email ID, and please mention your correct name. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, ma'am.